Наступне питання нашої секції – це адвокатська монополія, європейський досвід. Це питання, як і попереднє, є дискусійним і, як ви вже чули з виступів попередніх доповідачів, є прихильники цієї концепції, є ті, хто супротивники цієї концепції, а є і такі, які вважають в цілому, що монополія адвокатури повинна бути, але акцентують увагу на тому, що це повинно регламентуватися законодавчими актами, зокрема процесуальними кодексами, а не Конституцією України. Тому ми запросили до участі у форумі представників інших країн і хотіли б, щоб вони розкрили нам питання адвокатської монополії в контексті саме європейського досвіду. І це зробить наш наступний доповідач. І запрошуємо до слова нашого гостя, голову Асоціації адвокатів Литви Інгаса Вегеле. Прошу вас, пане Інгеле.
Доброго дня. Мне большая честь говорить в самой достойной аудитории юристов Украины. И честь, но имею только две минуты до ланча. Я хочу попросить вас не быть злым, особенно мужчин, потому что я точно не закончу за одну минуту до ланча, но я постараюсь вместиться в 10-12 минут, говоря про адвокатурской монополии. Я тоже хочу извиниться еще по одному вопросу. Я не могу говорить по-украински, не говорю так сильно по-русски. Термины юридические не очень легко даются мне по-русски, потому я попрошу надеть наушники тех, кому удобнее слышать по-русски, а я буду говорить по-английски. So my presentation relates to advocatory monopoly as a European experience.
Next slide, please. Everybody knows that this is a very much debated issue nowadays in Ukraine, as there is a constitutional judicial reform, and under the constitutional judicial reform, there is a provision providing that representation in court should be executed solely by advocates. There is a special list. Next slide, please. The advocacy monopoly is directly related to the right to a fair trial, which is provided in Article 6 of the Convention of European of the Human Rights. And the European Court of Justice, according to the practice of the European Court of Justice, European Court of Human Rights, the guarantee of the right to a fair trial must be considered to include the right to access to the courts in general, in civil, as well as in criminal matters. So it is very clear that the European Convention of Human Rights does not dictate to the state how to achieve that. The effects of the execution of Article 6. However, it should be noted that the European Convention leaves to the state a free choice of the means to be used for ensuring the effective right of access to the courts. It is not the court's function even to dictate to the state which measures should be taken to achieve that goal. Next slide, please. What relates to European Union law, probably all the advocates here know the most two important directives of European Union law, the Directive on the Freedom of Establishment of Advocates, the so-called Directive of 98, and the Directive on the Freedom to Provide Services for Advocates. Neither the directive prohibits or regulates the advocate's monopoly. The same would be said about the Services Directive, the General Directive that regulates all the services within the European Union. It does not regulate the what is monopoly. However, it should be noted that the advocate's directive for freedom of establishment and provision of services allows even to be more tough on the advocate's monopoly. I mean that the state could establish this special list even of advocates who are able to be present at the Supreme Court. So we even speak not only about the advocates monopoly in general, but we speak about the special list of advocates to be present at the Supreme Court. And that is part of European Union law. Next slide, please. Shortly, I will skip through the Lithuanian perspective, what we have in Lithuania. In criminal procedure, more or less, I could say that we have the monopoly of advocates to be presented to represent the party in the criminal procedures. Next slide, please. In civil procedure, we have the monopoly of representation only at the Supreme Court. At the first and second instance, the representatives of the parties could be not only the advocates, but could be other persons who are listed in the code of civil procedure. But the most important aspect here is that only if litigants were represented by an advocate, the court would adjudicate the reimbursement of the cost of the to the winning party from the losing party. This is how the state tries to ensure that the professional representation would be very important, or is a very important aspect in the civil procedure. Next slide, please. As relates to administrative offense procedure, unfortunately, we have not even the same monopoly, but we don't have even the possibility to regulate the persons who present themselves at the court. That sometimes it is possible to be even without the legal education at the administrative procedure in Lithuania. However, although currently we now have the parliamentarian commission and we have the draft law already, trying to make the same for the administrative procedure as it is for civil procedure in Lithuania. Next slide, please. Very short, the survey report, so-called survey report on the justice system of Europe, which provides that 9 states in the European Union, have a full monopoly in civil, criminal, and administrative matters. 9 states. 34 states have representation of the suspect or the accused only by advocates. 18 states. In the representation of the victim is a monopoly of advocates, and the administrative cases, 12 states. Next slide, please. Everybody knows that advocate monopoly relates to the right to the fair trial directive. There are special requirements for advocates. And that is how it is protected against the risk of the unfair trial. That is, legal education, 45 member states out of 47, required to complete an initial training. Then the same of the goes to continuous training. There are rules of ethics, next slide please. There are requirements to do liability, guarantees, and etc. Next slide please. The question remains, does the advocacy monopoly itself immediately provide sufficient protection against the risk of unfair trial? There are two very important aspects. How many advocates there are in the country? And does the fees of the advocate allow the process to go? In my opinion, Ukraine has enough advocates. And it is clearly shown by the survey report again. Ukraine has 244 lawyers for 100,000 population. Next slide, please. And what relates to Next slide, please. And what relates to the financial obstacles, most of the financial obstacles are solved by the state legal aid schemes which are in all and any European state. Next slide, please. And the conclusion. In my opinion, the representation of an advocate is a high degree, gives a high degree of legal protection. Insufficient number of advocates might be a breach of the right to a fair trial. However, the most important aspect here, and this was already mentioned by the report before me, Mr. Alexeyev Shkelakov has said that it is very important that effective activity of the National Bar Association should be it is a substantial contribution to the effective implementation of the right to a fair trial. And at the end, I think that encouragement of the professional representation by advocates is an advantage to the society and the justice system. It is an advantage to justice because we have a professional representation. It is an advantage for all and other members of the society. It could be done, by the way, in Ukraine, tried to do in the Dutch constitutional amendment by providing a monopoly of advocacy, or it could be done in a more soft way, as it is in Lithuania, by providing that only the persons who have been represented by the advocate may receive the adjudication cost for the litigation. Thank you so much.
I think it was on behalf of the advocates of Ukraine, because we really support what you said, and we really do what you said, and the one of the Ukraine is not that possible we should talk in Ukraine, however, we are doing our best on this. Thank you.
Thank you.